and welcome back to our continuing education program for pesticide applicators in Iowa. I'm Roger Brown from Extension Communications at Iowa State University. And as always, when Chuck Eckerman from the Iowa Department of Agriculture is our guest, we get lots and lots of questions, and we very much appreciate the questions that have come in. Let's begin answering our questions right away. Chuck, first of all, the 21-day exemption for new employees, is that working days, calendar days, or spraying days? That's from Clark County.
That would be calendar days. It would be 21 days from the date of initial employment.
Okay. Is there a minimum age limit to be a commercial pesticide applicator? That's a good question, I think.
There are no specific minimum requirements in the pesticide law. This type of question would be would hinge on child labor laws. Mm-hmm. And I believe it is a minimum requirement. It's either 16 or 18 years old for a commercial applicator to be certified, unless that individual is a family member in a family operated business. But I would suggest that if you have a question regarding that, that you probably should contact the Department of Labor on that.
Okay. In the application record, how do you describe the location of treatment? I'll ask that one first. That's from Mills County.
Okay, the location of the treatment could be handled in a number of different ways. It should be specific enough so that an inspector could look at the record and go right to the point of application. And this is going to change or be different for different types of applicators. If you're a lawn care applicator, the address is simple and is going to be probably adequate. If you're an agricultural applicator, then the location of the field along with the address may be necessary. Mm-hmm. So it depends on the type of application you're involved with, but it should be clear enough so that anybody that looks at the records could take the record and go to the point of application.
Okay. From Dickinson County, this question, can a greenhouse or nursery owner spray general use pesticide without being certified?
There have been changes that affect that type of situation. A non-commercial applicator is now defined in regulation, and a non-commercial applicator is an individual who works on their employer's property and would be required to be certified and licensed as a non-commercial applicator only when they're using restricted use pesticides. So if you're a greenhouse employee that is using general use pesticides, you're not required to be certified. We would recommend it, but it would not be technically required.
Okay. Also with us this morning is George Zappar. George is an extension agronomist here at Iowa State University. We have a question for you, George. Can Atrex be used in the fall?
No, it can't. They changed the label to prohibit the fall application, so it's no longer legal.
Okay, very quick answer. Chuck, back to you on container recycling. Why is it not required of everyone? From Story County.
I guess I have a real problem answering why type questions, but the legislature has worked with a number of bills in the last several years to try to address some type of mandatory container collection program. However, none of those bills have passed. We are, or the industry and the regulators, so to speak, are looking at different ways to deal with this, and currently I mentioned that we do have this pilot project for recycling, and if this works, we may look at that at ways that we may be able to address this problem in a more reasonable manner than what maybe have been suggested earlier, but I guess that's the best way I can answer. Okay. Everybody is looking and searching for better ways to deal with the container disposal problem.
Okay. Do ready-to-use pesticide containers have to be triple rinsed, and what do you do with the rinse water?
Okay, I'm not sure. The disposal instructions on the label would dictate whether the container should be triple rinsed, and I cannot honestly answer whether ready-to-use containers have that on their label. Certainly, it would be recommended that any container, whether it be a concentrated pesticide or a ready-to-use pesticide, be rinsed entirely to get as much of the pesticide residue out of that before disposing of it. There are a number of different ready-to-use containers, and I understand the problem that presents for what do you do with the rinse water. The standard recommendation is that the rinse water be applied to a labeled site. If you use the ready-to-use container to apply rinse water, you may want to do that several times in order to get as much of that pesticide out of it.
Okay. Wendy Winnestein is with us again. She's a coordinator for pesticide applicator training here at Iowa State in Extension. Wendy, are there any videos or training aids companies can borrow to do their own certification exam training? That from Linn County.
We don't have a videotape available at this time. It's been one of our goals to have something like that produced. On a very limited basis, occasionally we'll loan out the slide sets that we use for mm-hmm. training if it doesn't conflict with the training schedule that we're conducting.
Okay. Back to you, Chuck. Certified handlers are only required to pass a single test. What about sales personnel or behind-the-counter people who only recommend applications but don't actually apply the product? Can they get by with only a single test?
Okay, this issue was was addressed in the recent rules that were adopted. Originally, the rules did, when the rules were proposed, it was required that a person making recommendations be certified. However, the end result, the rules presently do not require an individual that's making recommendations only to be certified. However, anybody that makes recommendations that's contrary to the label instructions is subject to penalty. It is against the law to make recommendations contrary to the label instructions.
Okay. If a pesticide is canceled, can application records before cancellation be used in legal actions?
I guess they could be. It depends on what type of situation you're dealing with. Mm-hmm. But if the legal action is because an application was made inconsistent with the label, that certainly could be a possibility.
Okay. Review, if you would, please. Who needs 6 hours of training and who needs 4 hours?
Okay, there are three categories of certification that are required to have 6 hours, and that's Category 7A, which is the general pest control categories, Category 7B, which is the termite category, and Category 7C, which is the fumigation. Anybody certified in any one of those three categories would be required to have 6 hours each year. Anybody certified in any other category would be required to have 4 hours.
Okay. From Sioux County, this question, what is the distance from a city well when spraying pesticides?
Okay, that is not, currently there are not any specific setback requirements when spraying next to wells, unless it would be addressed on the label of the product being applied, except for those restrictions that I outlined earlier for atrazine. So if atrazine was applied near a well, any type of well, mm-hmm. you would have to have a 50-foot setback. But there are no other regulations that are specific to other pesticides that I'm aware of far as applying near wells.
Okay. And this is a question that relates directly to what you just said. The city has a well on agricultural land. Who's responsible for meeting the atrazine 50-foot setback, the city or the applicator?
Well, the applicator would be initially responsible.
Okay. Is the sign size new this year, and what material should it be, metal or plastic?
Okay, the sign size depending on what type of application you're referring to, but it is a minimum of 4x5 for residential lawn type applications. Mm-hmm. The signs, any type of situation where sign is used for posting, it's required to be weather resistant. So okay. It could be metal or plastic, both.
Okay, and what's the distance from a house with a continuous lot? That's from Polk County.
Okay, the distance from a house with a continuous lot, I'm not sure. I understand that type of situation, but if you're posting a lawn that has been treated, the minimum requirement would be that you have one sign posted in the front of the house within 2 to 5 feet from the curb or the sidewalk. With all these posting regulations, there's no way that we can adopt regulations that would be specific to each situation. So it's okay. Advisable to use your best judgment when you have different situations that may need additional signs.
Okay, from Wapello County, when spraying Roundup around trees, do you need to post, and does the sign need to be laminated paper?
Okay, again, the sign needs to be weather resistant for at least a period of 24 hours. When you're spot spraying around trees or in an area, if it's urban area, it would still be required to be posted.
Okay, here's a case where there's a golf course surrounded by residences. Are there these houses subject to the pre-notification requirement?
Okay, if a resident that has a property that abuts to the golf course would request to be notified, then the golf course would be required to give that individual pre-notification.
But it's up to the resident to ask for
the resident must ask for that.
Are posting signs commercially available, or does each company print their own? From Washington County.
There are several commercial companies that are involved in producing most of the signs that I'm aware of, and you might ask other companies that are involved in the same type of business that you are, where they got their signs made, and that they may be able to help with that.
Okay, one more quick question, and we have more than we can answer. We appreciate that. Where do you dump malathion rinsate if you can't pour it back in the sprayer?
With any pesticide, if you have a rinsate, it would be recommended that the rinsate be applied to an area that is labeled on that particular pesticide. So malathion, there would be a number of alternatives where you could apply that rinsate and at the same time dispose of it.
Very good. Chuck, thanks very much. And thanks to Wendy and George, too, for being with us. And thanks to our telephone answerers this morning, Ken Holcher and Donald Lewis from the Entomology Department at Iowa State. Thank you so much for calling in. We had more questions than we could answer. There will be more training. There will be more satellite uplinks. And we'll be back. Thanks for watching. Take care. I'm Roger Brown.